Good morning to everyone.
Good morning.
I welcome all of you today, and especially to all of our guests. It's a joy to see each and every one of you here today as we come together as God's precious children to worship Him and to be strengthened in our faith in Him, word and song. We're going to see today that it is Jesus Himself who has called each and every one of you to come and follow Him. And He did that through His Word. And He wants you to take every opportunity to listen to Him, to adhere to that Word, so that you may continue to grow stronger in your faith and assurance in Him that He is your Lord and Savior, that you are forgiven and have life in salvation. And then that we not only keep this, or that not only do we not keep this to ourselves, but that we share it with others, as we shall see today. And so with that, we'll begin our service this morning in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And we'll continue now with the singing of hymn 249.
Worship Him.
as together we sing Psalm 67. Now, this is a prayer to God. The psalmist here is asking God to be gracious to us, to bless us, and to make his face shine upon us, and to keep us ever faithful to him. And we're also praying that he enter the lives of other people who don't know him, so that they too can know Jesus as their Lord and Savior and look forward to receiving eternal life with him in heaven.
Him. It wasn't that he didn't know him,
But God had never spoken to him. He didn't know the voice of God. The Lord called Samuel a third time, and Samuel got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am. You called me." Then Eli realized that the Lord was calling the boy. So Eli told Samuel, "Go and lie down, and if he calls you, say, 'Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening.'" So Samuel went and lay down in his place. And the Lord came and stood there calling as at other times, "Samuel, Samuel." And Samuel said, "Speak, for your servant is listening." Here ends our reading. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son, who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. And we'll continue now with the singing of hymn 283.
Follow me. And Philip, like Andrew and
Peter was from the town of Bethsaida. Philip found Nathanael and told him, "We have found the one Moses wrote about in the law, and about whom the prophets also wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph." "Nazareth? Can anything good come from there?" Nathanael asked. "Come and see," said Philip. And when Jesus saw Nathanael approaching, he said of him, "Here is a true Israelite in whom there is nothing false." "How do you know me?" Nathanael asked. And Jesus answered, "I saw you while you were still under the fig tree before Philip called you." Then Nathanael declared, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." And Jesus said, "You believe because I told you that I saw you under the fig tree. And you shall see greater things than that," he added. "I tell you the truth. You shall see heaven open and the angels of God ascending and descending on the Son of Man." So far, our text. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ Jesus, when Malachi the prophet died around 400 BC, the word of the Lord fell silent. Now Malachi was the last prophet in the Old Testament. And after that, as I said, there were no other prophets for the next 400 years. No one like an Elijah or Isaiah or Jeremiah who was sent by God to be so influential upon the people. Now, true, they had much of the Old Testament writings at that time, but they had no one to really direct them or to give them any hope. Now, at that time, the Pharisees had gotten started, and they were preaching about God's word, but they weren't teaching the truth. They were telling people that one was saved by their works, by following the commandments and the rules and the regulations of the rabbis. That's what's going to get you into heaven, they said. But there were those who knew better. They knew that they were horrible sinners, that they could never, ever save themselves, for the law can only condemn a person. And so these people had learned to put their trust in the promised Messiah, the Savior who would come to deliver them from all of their sins. But in the meantime, it must have been horrible for those people. It's like, well, whatever has become of God, if he's silent, then what's my hope? Are his promises still good? Has God abandoned us? It was a terrible godly silence for the believers. But understand that God always knows what he's doing, because he's the perfect God, the only God. And when he felt that the time was right, then the voice was back. Meaning that we will see today that silence was shattered. It was shattered, first of all, by the voice of John the Baptist, but more importantly, by Jesus' own voice and work. 700 years before Jesus came into the world, Isaiah was a prophet sent by God. And he had talked about how there would be a forerunner, someone who would come to prepare the way for Jesus. And that was the voice of John the Baptist. And again, John led people to see themselves as sinners, condemned to hell, then to get them to repent of their sins, to put their trust in Jesus, and to know that through Jesus they would be forgiven. And when they accepted that through the power of the Holy Spirit, They then were baptized to give proof and evidence that they had become members of God's family, destined, forgiven, and destined to be with him in heaven someday. And when it came to John's message, he told people that a greater one is coming, one who would come to gather wheat and burn the chaff. He said, the Messiah is coming and is even here. In fact, John said, everything Moses and the prophets said is coming to pass right now. But he said to them, when he comes, don't be afraid of him. He's not coming as some horrible, terrible judge to condemn you for your sins. Instead, John says, he is the Lamb of God who is coming to take away the sin of the world. And when Jesus came, he did just that. He came with love and compassion, mercy. He treated people with gentleness, kindness. He was there to teach people the truth of God's word, law, gospel, sin, and grace. He called people to come and follow him, as well as reaching out and healing people of their diseases. He even raised some people from the dead. And not only did he reach out to the Jews, but to the Gentiles as well. And because of his kindness and goodness, Gentiles followed him. Sinners adored him. And little children called him Son of David. Yes, he was truly the Lamb of God who came into this world and treated people with gentleness and humbleness, and went even to the point of death. Death on a cross, so that you and I could all be forgiven of our sins. Yes. You and I, we needed this Lamb who is also our good shepherd, because Satan, our enemy, oh, he just loves to fill our souls with darkness and make sin seem like it is something that is good, right, and a noble thing to do. And when we get caught up in sin and we find ourselves ignoring God and what he has to say in his word, and we're led astray, and then we're influenced by other people, and we find ourselves becoming very selfish and inconsiderate. And when this happens, we start ignoring our neighbor and turning against them, whispering against our neighbor, and generally treating one another as if they were not someone for whom Christ died. When you and I sin in every way, we offend God and his holiness. Yes, our sins are no small thing. They're a personal offense against God. Sin, rebellion against God, is a God-sized problem. And you and I are nowhere big enough to solve that problem. But now we hear a new voice. Not just the voice of John the Baptist, the voice of Jesus. And with his own voice, he came into this world to shatter the silence, to preach and teach that he is the way, the truth, and the life. That he truly is the Messiah. And we hear, just prior to our text, how Jesus called Andrew. And when Andrew, he told him to come follow me, and he did. And as Andrew listened to the voice of Jesus, He was comforted by his message of love and peace and forgiveness. And he was so filled with joy and comforted by this that he ran and told his brother Simon. He says, "We have found the Messiah," that is, the Christ, the anointed, the chosen one to save us from our sins. And we hear how Simon came to listen to Jesus as well. And then the next day, we hear how Jesus found Philip. And he said to Philip, "Come, follow me." And he did. And he too listened to that word of mercy and grace and peace and forgiveness. And he was so impressed by it that he went to tell his friend Nathanael. And he told him, "We have found the one Moses wrote about in the law, about whom the prophets also wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph." Nathanael said, Nazareth? Can anything good come from there?" The reason Nathanael said that is because Nazareth is a hilly area with lots of caves, and lots of thieves and robbers like to hide out there. Philip said, "I'm not going to force you, but why don't you come and see?" And when Jesus saw Nathanael approaching, he said of him, "Here is a true Israelite in whom there is nothing false." "How do you know me?" Nathanael asked. And Jesus answered, "I saw you while you were still under the fig tree before Philip called you." You have to understand, Jesus was not in eyesight of Nathanael. He was some distance away. But Jesus is the omniscient, or the omnipresent one, the one who is present everywhere. And he's also omniscient because, remember, he is both true God and true man. And being the omniscient one, he was all-knowing. So he knew exactly where Nathanael was, sitting under a fig tree. And notice how he specifies the tree. And he also knew exactly what Nathanael was doing. He was praying to God about the sending of the Messiah. Well, as Jesus spoke to him, the Holy Spirit was working on Nathanael's heart. And Nathanael declared, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God, you are the King of Israel." The Spirit led him to believe that Jesus was God's own Son. And so Jesus was shattering the silence with his word of salvation. And John wrote this so that we too may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God. In fact, later on, John writes, "These are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing, you may have eternal life." Jesus went around with authority, with power, showing that he truly was the Messiah, that there was no one else in all this world who had come to be our promised Messiah, our Savior from sin, death, and hell. And besides that, the silence had already been broken with Jesus' infant cries there in Bethlehem. And then later, as he lived out his life in a perfect, holy manner. And then there was John the Baptist, who recognized him as the Lamb of God to be slain. As he said, "Christ has come to save those who came to save all who are sinful, just as Moses and the prophets said." And how would Jesus do this? by his perfect, sinless life, his innocent sufferings, and death. Now, this baby, as I said, grew up as both true God and true man. And as I said, he lived that perfect, sinless life. And as he did, he educated people in the truth of his word. And many people did come to faith in him. The Spirit worked through that word, just like he's done with all of you. It is Jesus who called you. It's the Spirit who's worked faith into you so that, and now through the word, he strengthens your faith and he reassures you that he is the true Savior. Well, when it came time, he went to the cross. And there at Calvary, it looked as if Satan had won the battle, not Jesus. In fact, Jesus cried out, my God, why have you forsaken me? There was silence. Jesus knew. That was his whole purpose for coming. To go to the cross, to suffer, to endure the punishment, the hell that you and I deserved for every sin that we've committed in thought, word, and deed. It was there in hell that he washed away our sins. And he did it with his holy, perfect, precious blood. When Jesus said, it is finished, he was stating, I have accomplished everything necessary for your salvation. And after saying that, he then said, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. He had won the greatest victory in the world. And we have that all recorded for us here in the scriptures. Then, on the third day, after Jesus had been placed in the tomb, the silence of heaven again was shattered. It was broken by the sound of an earthquake. Then came the announcement of the angel, he is not here, he has risen. Death and the grave were no match for the Lamb, the Savior, this Christ. Because he was perfect, he was sinless. Death can't hold you in the grave. When you're free of all sin, when you are sinless, you continue to live. And you live in the glories of heaven. And so for us, Jesus truly is our Savior. He is for us forever. In fact, he told Nathanael, I tell you the truth, you shall see heaven open and the angels of God ascending and descending on the Son of Man. He was going back to the time when Jacob had deceived his father Isaac to try and get the birthright, which he did. But he also got the inheritance along with it. And when Esau, his brother, heard about that, he was angry. So angry he wanted to kill Jacob. And so Isaac and Rebekah told Jacob, go. And flee. Go to your Uncle Laban's place. And so he ran. Well, by nighttime, he was tired, he lay down, and he had this vision. There was a stairway from earth all the way up to heaven, and there were angels running up and down, and there was Jesus at the top. And Jesus said to Jacob, I forgive you for your sins. And Jacob truly was repentful for what he had done. God forgave him. And he was telling Jacob that from his line would come the Savior. He's saying, I will come. I will save all mankind from their sins. You can trust in that. And so what Jesus was telling Nathanael, I am that Jesus Christ. There is no other way into heaven except through me. I, Jesus, am the stairway that links heaven and earth. And you, Nathanael, you're going to see that someday. You'll see it through my works. You'll see it when you yourself will leave this world and you will join me in heaven. The silence has been shattered and is still shattered to this very day. Through the means of grace, every day, Jesus is there to talk to you and to assure you through his word, through his sacraments, that he loves each and every one of you in a special way. That he has forgiven you for all of your sins. That he is with you and walks with you hand in hand every day. And that he will never ever leave you nor forsake you. Not only that, but the door has been opened. What a privilege. He who should have punished us for our sins, instead, we now can come to him. We can talk to him. We can pray to him and share our feelings and our wishes and desires and our frustrations with him. And he listens. He hears us. And we can come to worship him and sing praises to him. So, as he calls you to be his children, take every opportunity to listen to him, to treasure his word of comfort, which can bring peace, joy, peace, comfort, and hope to your life, as Philip and Nathanael found. And know for a fact that this Jesus truly is the Christ, who has saved you and prepared an awesome place for you in heaven. And as I said, don't keep this to yourself. No. This is a message that we need to share with our family, friends, neighbors, co-workers, classmates, with everybody, and especially those who don't know Jesus, so that they too can have that peace and joy. Just like after Andrew telling his brother Peter, or Philip telling his good friend Nathanael, go out there and share that good news. And then say with King David, you will fill me with joy in your presence, dear Lord, with eternal pleasures at your right hand. We know. We know that is going to be the case because the silence has been shattered. Thank God that through Jesus, you and I have the truth of knowing that you are loved by God, forgiven by God, and destined to be with him forever in heaven. Amen. Now may the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus, our Lord and Savior. Amen. And we'll continue now with the singing of hymn 561.
Thank you.
our service at page 50 in the front part of your hymnal with the Kyrie. And then after that, we'll ask Mr. Dave White to come forward so that we can install him as a new member of our church council. In the morning, O Lord, I call to you. Be merciful to me and hear my prayer. We have different gifts according to the grace given us. If a man's gift is prophesying, let him use it in proportion to his faith. If it is serving, let him serve. If it is teaching, let him teach. If it is encouraging, let him encourage. If it is contributing to the needs of others, let him give generously. If it is leadership, let him govern diligently. And if it is showing mercy, let him do it cheerfully. The Lord seeks faithfulness from all who serve. As Scripture says, it is required that those who have been given a trust must prove faithful. And the Lord does not seek from us what he has not given to us. But when he does give a gift, his will is that we use it faithfully to his glory and for the benefit of his people. You are also, as a servant of Christ and a worker in this congregation, to set for your own family and the whole Christian church example of a Christian life. Make the Word of God your foundation and guide. Search it daily for comfort and instruction, so that the congregation may be assured of your willingness to serve. I ask you in the presence of God and of this congregation, will you diligently and faithfully carry out the office entrusted to you according to the ability which God has given you? If so, then answer, yes, with the help of God.
Yes, with the help of God.
I now install you as a vice president of Grace Evangelical Lutheran Church in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. May God grant you his Holy Spirit and give you wisdom and strength to carry out your duties to his glory and for the good of his people. And members of Grace, I urge you to regard all the members of the church council as servants of Jesus Christ and God's gift to his church. Pray for them, support them in their service, and help them so that through the gospel ministry of this congregation, more people will be reached for Christ and his kingdom. And we pray. Merciful and gracious God, our lives are open before you, and you hear our promises. We ask you to send your Holy Spirit into the hearts of your servants, that they may carry out their duties with diligence, boldness, and wisdom. Give them a spirit of devotion and prayer, that in every time of need, they may present their requests to you. Help them be examples of what is good, that by their lives they may build up your congregation and give the enemies of the church no cause for complaint. Make them a blessing to your believers. Help them to work with me, their pastor, and with one another, and grant that by their service the unity of this congregation may be strengthened, your name be hallowed, your kingdom be enlarged, and your will be done. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Amen. We also pray the prayer which our Lord has taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Go then, and give yourself fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. The Almighty and merciful God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless and preserve you. Go in peace. Thank you very, very much. You can remain seated. We'll continue at the bottom of page 50 with the prayer for grace. O Lord, our Heavenly Father, Almighty and Everlasting God, you have brought us safely to this new day. Defend us with your mighty power, and grant that this day we neither fall into sin nor run into any kind of danger. And in all that we do, direct us to what is right in your sight. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Amen. Let us praise the Lord. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be and abide with you all. And we'll conclude our service with the singing of hymn 560, verses 1 and 5. Okay, 1 and 5. Our guests, we'd love to have you sign your name in our guest book and to come back and worship with us. with us again soon.